It's shaping up to be a fruitful year for beverage kiosk giant Frutas. Now, Frutas Holdings is looking to expand its reach and operations after its first quarter earnings beat pre-pandemic numbers. According to Calvin Chua, Frutas' director and chief financial advisor, they are looking to add more brands and open 50 more stores within the year.
In terms of profitability, there's a number of headwinds still facing us in terms of inflation. But, you know, as this subside, we are confident that, you know, the base that we are starting from with the increased productivity efficiency, targeting at least 30% revenue growth this year. But we see further upside if our expansion plans can be implemented faster.
Now to the corporate front, Megawide gets shareholders' approval to push ahead with its plan to acquire affiliate PH One World Developers from its parent company Citicore Holdings Investments for 5 billion pesos. Citicore will also transfer some 570 million common shares in PH One to Megawide. Megawide says it hopes to earn stable revenues from PH1's vertical and horizontal developments like the My Enso Lofts in Quezon City and the Modan Lofts in Pasig and Taytay Rizal. Megawide is behind public-private partnership projects such as the Cebu Mactan International Airport and the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange. Solaire is looking for 4,200 workers for upcoming integrated resort operations in Quezon City. That's for next year. The gaming and hotel firm launched a career caravan and boutique on Wednesday. The job openings range from marketing, IT, finance, and hospitality management. Solaire Resort North, the second Solaire-branded property in the Philippines, will rise in the Ayala Group's Vertis North in the first quarter of 2024. The International Monetary Fund coming to the rescue of cash-strapped Pakistan. Now, the IMF's board green-lighted a $3 billion bailout package for Pakistan, which is aimed at stabilizing the Southeast or South Asian country's ailing economy. The latest lifeline for Pakistan, which has been on the verge of default, came after 8 months of tough negotiations over fiscal discipline. The IMF wants Islamabad to ensure a tight monetary policy aimed at disinflation and further progress on structural reforms. China's exports in June contracting at its fastest pace since the onset of the coronavirus pandemic. Data show Beijing's exports dropped more than 12% last month, worse than the 7.5% decline in May. It's also higher than what analysts expected at 9.5%. As for Chinese imports, it was also down 6.8% from the 4.5% in May. The figures brought China's trade surplus swelling to $76 billion in June from $65.8 billion in the previous month. Beijing's Customs Bureau says the country's trade will continue to face great pressure this second half of the year, in part due to a slowdown in global economic recovery, high inflation, and even geopolitics. Here's how the financial markets reacted to the cooler U.S. inflation data. Now, major indices in Asia-Pacific traded higher this Thursday. The Chinese markets showing resilience even with disappointing trade data from Beijing. Hong Kong's Hang Seng also led today's rally, climbing 2.5%. We're seeing the Kospi also up as South Korea's central bank left its rates unchanged at 3.5%. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. They're pointing to an open in the green following the cooler-than-expected U.S. inflation report. Now, aside from China's trade numbers, investors there are also digesting a slew of economic data releases from the United Kingdom. That includes Britain's GDP shrinking 0.1% in May, which is actually better than the 0.3% contraction that was forecast. Over on Wall Street, the major U.S. indices look set to extend gains. But a cautious sentiment is expected, with more key data expected to come in, such as the producer price index and initial jobless claims. Global public debt hits a record $92 trillion in 2022. That's according to a report by the United Nations. It said this is due to government's borrowing to counter crises such as the COVID pandemic. Developing countries owe almost 30% of global debt. The UN said lenders should expand their financing with measures such as a temporary suspension of surcharges.
Half of our world is sinking into a development disaster fueled by a crushing debt crisis. That is the main message of the report we are presenting today, A World of Debt. Some 3.3 billion people, almost half of humanity, live in countries that spend more on debt interest payments than on education or health. And yet, because most of these unsustainable debts are concentrated in poor countries, they are not judged to pose a systemic risk to the global financial system. And some of the poorest countries in the world are being forced into a choice between servicing their debt or serving their people.
China slamming the U.S. for allegedly spreading disinformation. This after U.S. officials and tech giant Microsoft said China-based hackers breached the email accounts of over 20 organizations, including at least two American government agencies. The White House said these were detected immediately and no further breaches were made. China, though, is vehemently denying the allegation.
I would like to say that in the past, it was usually the world's number one hacking group, the U.S. National Security Agency, which also serves as the U.S. Cyber Force Command that released such kind of disinformation. This time, it was the U.S. National Security Council that made a public statement. Whatever agency spoke, it does not change the fact that the U.S. is the world's biggest hacking empire and global cyber thief.
Elon Musk joining the AI revolution. The billionaire tycoon is launching an AI firm called xAI to take on Microsoft and OpenAI's ChatGPT. Musk, who had previously called for the technology's regulation, says the AI startup was created to understand reality. xAI's team includes several former engineers and scientists from Microsoft, Google, and even OpenAI. It's not yet game over for the U.S. Federal Trade Commission when it comes to Microsoft's nearly $69 billion deal to acquire video game maker Activision Blizzard. The FTC has filed an appeal that seeks to reverse a judge's decision ruling in favor of the two companies. The FTC first sued to block the acquisition last December. It argues the deal is anti-competitive as Microsoft could make some games exclusive to its own consoles or affect players' experience on Activision games on rival services. Microsoft denies this and said it would instead make the games more widely available. The deal, the biggest in the video game industry, is expected to push through by July 18 if it leaps past this last legal hurdle.